The scriptures pertaining to Joseph from his rejection and his descent to his rise to power in Egypt, it's all about restoration. You see, we serve an Elohim who is all about restoring things to their original purpose, restoration. And one of the biggest enemies of restoration is rejection and division. And I'll tell you this, rejection is painful, but it's a lot more painful than pain itself. And Joseph experienced probably the pinnacle of rejection when his own family wanted nothing to do with him anymore. And all of us in here come from some form of a dysfunctional family. And parents today, we might have our children in here. We're like, I thought I'd never hear that. You know, it's just because of things that have transpired from the beginning, there's always going to be a taste of dysfunction in every single family. But restoration and unification are the tools that Abba uses. That's why that term Abba is, if I can respectfully say that, is even more intimate than Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh for us, because he's a father to us. That's very intimate. He's relating to us on some terms that we can really comprehend as human beings. You know, no matter what nationality you come from, no matter what religion you practice, we pray for deliverance for those who are practicing a religion that is contrary to what Scripture says, of course. But there's a term, a universal term that we can all relate to, and it's Abba. It's Father. It's Mother, Ima. It's these terms. And our amazing Yahweh or Yahuwah or Yehovah, however it is you pronounce it, whatever your conviction is, I respect that. He has given us that aspect of Abba, of Father, to relate to him and to connect with him and to remind us of the importance of restoration. The term Father is it's not like a term of endearment. It's a term of restoring. Fathers are responsible for their homes. Fathers are responsible for bringing restoration to homes. And sometimes that's painful. Why? Because we have to come through the rejection of our own life. And in the process of that, sometimes our children experience the process of us coming through the process of rejection. But see, the Father, he's amazing. He teaches us some amazing principles that we can grasp in the Torah portions, especially with Joseph. This Torah portion with Joseph is like, it's probably a most people's favorite, because it's like, wow, not only a picture of the Messiah and what the Messiah would go through, but man, just this amazing mercy, especially in chapter 45, this amazing aspect of forgiveness. Wow. The power of forgiveness is seen in this week's Torah portion. Last week was Maketz, the Torah portion Maketz, which speaks of the end. This week, the name of this week's Torah portion is Vayigash, that we're getting ready to get into, and it's about the reunification of the whole house of Israel. And we know that Elohim ever made a covenant with Gentiles? He made a covenant with who? Abraham. He made a covenant with Noah and all these different types of covenants, right? But his sole focus was what? Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 31 to 33. He made a covenant for the restoring and the reunification of the whole house of Israel. Not just what some religious men say in Jerusalem today, bring the Jews home. And then some Christian leaders today out here in America saying, yeah, that's a good idea. Let's fund this thing and let's get the Jews back to Israel. And rejecting the whole prophetic plan, that's still going to happen, no matter what religious guys do. But he's in the business of restoring the whole house of Israel, not just some small portion that some rabbinic authorities who are, we're not going to get into it, who are probably not even Jewish themselves, walking under the guise of being Jewish as Ashkenazis, as descendants of something different. And here we are, religious guys, submitting to that and going with the status quo, and still the blinders are on. But you know what? Joseph is waking up. Joseph is in the exile. He's waking up. And Ezekiel chapter 37 speaks of the eights, the trees. They're not sticks. Two trees coming together in one hand and unifying them. The power to do that is amazing. The friction, the pressure. When it's in the hand, that means there's a squeezing process taking place, and the friction and energy for that to make that happen does not feel good. You see, there has to be pressure and there has to be a squeezing process in order for the two sticks to become one. There has to be. So when the Father brings these things out in the prophets, we can rest assured that whatever he said is going to happen. And we can be encouraged with that. So hopefully you guys are all right with us reading the whole Torah portion, the Haftorah portion. That's the best part, is to read it and hear what the words have to say. And then our spirit man and our minds can go on and dive into some things. But I do want to look at something. Because we've been in a state of nakedness ever since the Garden of Eden. We might have clothes on, but we're naked. We might have clothes on, but we're naked. We might have tzitzits on, but we're still naked. We might have tallits on. Some people wear their kippah. That's cool. Right? We might have all the right things on, but we are still naked. And he's coming to clothe us with the glory, the splendor that we had in the beginning. He's going to do it. The process has already begun. The blood has been shed. The stone was rolled away. The ascension has already happened. The seat has been filled at the right hand. We're going to be clothed again with the splendor that we were intended to be clothed with in the beginning. And it's brighter than the sun. It's a beautiful garment. We can't even comprehend that. So speaking of nakedness, if I can say this, these two trees in Ezekiel 8, can you say 8? 8 is made up of an ayin and a tzaddik, so feet. There's these Hebrew letters. And you guys know, I don't have a whole lot of that, but I do have these things, the ones that are very interesting for us in this Torah portion. I find it interesting that both these sticks, there's two, right? They come together. The doubling of that word for stick, which is really tree, gives us the numerical connection of the word for nakedness found back in Genesis. Wow. So both houses, I don't care how religious Brother Judah might present himself today, he's still naked. And the more Talmud someone might get into, the more naked you become, literally. We are in the process of embracing the voice that spoke from Mount Sinai. That's the beginning process of being clothed again. The garments of praise are the garments of his Torah, the garments of his truth. So I find that very interesting that we need to be returning to what is known as the royal covenant that James talks about. There's a royal law that we need to return to. There is a royal aspect of the Torah that was intended from the beginning that we need to walk in. And that is the sign of Joseph rising up to his place and position. We need to return to this covenant that the Father has given us. I have a subtitle for this week. and I named it Prophecies, Priesthoods, and Political Deception. I try to get things that rhyme. So I try to get things that rhyme, and that's just a picture I found, I think on Wikipedia or something, I don't know, somewhere on the internet. But this week's Torah portion is the portion that introduces the first exile from the land of promise. They leave the land of Canaan and they go down into Egypt because of an exile. Patterns, like Eddie Chumney said this, prophecy is really biblical history. I like that phrase. When I first heard that, I was like, that makes so much sense. True prophecy is scriptural history. What you see happen in the past will unfold and happen again. It's a cycle. It's not going to be anything new. We just have to look at the patterns. So we already have begun the process of coming out of a linear type thinking. And our mindset is following the very cycles of our DNA, cyclical thinking. So we got that right. So now we need to start looking at these things. That's why you can ask somebody, how many of you are excited? I'm asking you guys right now. And by the vote of your teruah, how many of you are excited about what Elohim is doing in the earth?
Amen.
Some of you are unsure. You're just like, it's all right. So with that, most of you shouted, which was great. So here's the other question. How many of you know what he's doing? That's the thing we have to look at and think about. We have to really get in there. So he wants us to be in tune with what is going on. And we have reached actually the climax between Yosef and his brothers, specifically Judah. Judah is having a change of heart. And we're going to look at this. Our portion begins with Judah pouring out his heart to who he thinks is an Egyptian leader, a prince of Egypt. You guys saw the cartoon, the Prince of Egypt. This is who he thinks he is because this is what he's looking at. And today, if we can respectfully say this, Brother Judah is not jealous with what Christianity is doing as a whole. He's not. He's looking and saying they don't got it. And I'm not trying to put down people, but as a whole, until Joseph wakes up completely and begins to put on the garments of praise, and his practice is that of the Torah when it comes to Sabbaths, Moedims, and so on and so forth, Brother Judah's not going to be jealous. But as soon as he starts seeing, like you guys in here, you're embracing Shabbat and you're doing things more closely lined up to the Torah than Brother Judah is. They're on the other side of the fence trying to do all these other things that have no foundation in the actual written scripture. It's making Brother Judah very jealous. Who do you think you are, you Gentile? Well, Brother Judah, I'm not a Gentile anymore, if I can say that. I'm your brother Joseph. It's just I had the wrong clothing on for so long because I didn't know. I tried to cover up my nakedness with Christmas and Easter and all these other things. I thought that was the thing to do. But now I'm taking off those jackets that don't even fit and I'm putting on the wardrobe of heaven, if I can say that. I am wearing the garments that I was intended to wear. Judah believes he's standing before this king, but in reality, he's standing before his very own brother, Yosef. But he can't tell because all this other stuff's on him. And we touched a little bit on that the other week. There will be a future reunion. I want you guys to hear this. I only quote certain things that, like this rabbi here, Rabbi Menachem Mendel Schneerson, just this one quote, I'm like, it's in their face. It's there. It's in Brother Judah's face. Look at this. This is his quote. There will be a future reunion of Judah and Joseph in order for Judah to bring on Messiah ben David and realize the promise. My servant, here's the promise, David shall be their prince forever. Judah must first do as the patriarch Judah did when he came near unto Joseph and received initial influence from Joseph. We can follow the pattern of history and see this play out again for the final actual action. Those are quotes from this Orthodox rabbi. In other words, he's saying, what we saw Judah do, brothers and sisters of Orthodoxy, he's saying, we have to do the same thing. We have to return to Joseph, who is Yahushua HaMashiach. It's there, it's embedded, but the garments have to be changed in order for that to happen. It was Yehuda or Judah who had years earlier cooperated with his brothers to do what? Betray Joseph. The 21-year-long separation has reached the pinnacle now. And now Yosef has been able to recreate something of the original situation. He's recreating everything that happened to him with them selling it. I'm going to give you guys some really interesting gems from the Torah. You guys heard? Joseph said, you guys are spies. You're meraglim. Say meraglim. You guys are spies. You're here spying out all my wealth. You see, Joseph learned something when he was in the pit. He didn't cry. There's no real text saying that he was screaming his head off. I believe that he stood still when he was at the bottom of that pit and he began to remain still to hear the voice of the Father. And he began to learn some things in the midst of that pit. You know what? A lot of us, we enter into a pit. People probably threw us in a pit. They probably threw us under the bus. They did all these things. And guess what? We're going off at the mouth instead of being still and do. See, Joseph, if you're Joseph, you have to recognize that it was Yahweh that sent you here to preserve life. In the midst of all that, that's hard to say. That's actually hard to embrace unless you walk in his ruach. When we walk in his spirit, we'll be able to discern the difference of his permission and other things that are transpiring. He's allowing things to happen. But he says, you guys are spies, and we're going to get into that in just a moment. So it's been 21 years. And now Joseph has been able to recreate something of the original situation. The brothers are again in control of the life and death of a son of Rachel, which she had too, remember? This time, however, Judah will lay aside his fear of imprisonment and perhaps even death at the hands of this Egyptian and to defend and rescue his brother Benjamin. Do you guys know that it's the love of Yahweh, not emotional love. It is this love, ahava, the ahava of Abba that will draw men to themselves, unto him, excuse me, that will draw all men unto himself. It is his love, not judgmental things. It is the love, the ahava of the Father that will draw all men unto himself. We need to be walking in the same manner. Right. We do. In John 15:13, it says this. The scripture says this. Greater love has no one this than to lay down one's life for his friends. Judah has realized this very fact now for the first time. 1 John 3:16. For we know love because he laid down his life for us. And we also should lay our lives down for our brothers and sisters. We should also do that. Imagine doing this. This is something me and my wife have going. I said, you know what? I said, hey, let's do something. I said, every day, let's try to do a few acts of kindness for each other without having to be asked anything, just acts of kindness with one another. If you're married in here, try doing that. Husbands, out of nowhere, just do something kind for your wife. Step out of yourself and go overboard and do something out of the ordinary for your wife. Wives, step out of your busy self as well and go and do something out of the ordinary for your husband. An act of kindness, and then let that just kind of flow out to your children, to your neighbors, to your brethren. Let it become something real. Let's see if this Torah really has legs and hands in my life, in our life. Let's do that. It works for me and my wife. It's amazing. Out of nowhere. Then once you start getting in the pattern of laying your life down, it doesn't stop. It just keeps on going. And it keeps going. It just doesn't stop. All of a sudden, you're putting legs and arms to the Torah. Not just being Pharisaical, which none of us should be, and just like a robot, but putting legs, putting boots to the ground. And putting arms to that. Creating the power of His Torah in your life so that what? This is how they will know that you are my disciples, the love you have one towards another. Let your works so shine so that men will see your good works and glorify your Father who's in heaven. That's the Torah, really. It's not all the numerical stuff and the secret thing and the root number here and the pictograph. Well, this picture, those things are great, and I have those here too. But ultimately, it's putting feet to the Word. Putting arms to the Word. Doing something. And guess what? No one has to know about it. Absolutely. Acts of loving kindness. We need to practice that more. I point at myself first. It will be after a 2-year famine and self-examination when Yeshua will come to the place of Teshuvah, Israel. Remember last week? It was at the end of 2 years. Well, it's pretty much at the end of 2 years right now. Since the time of His resurrection to the time we're living in, we are coming to the pinnacle of a very prophetic time. We really are. Repentance is still the call. It was the call of the prophets. It was the call of Yohanan, the immerser. Repentance is still the call. Is there like a ringing? You guys hear a ringing? I do too. Is it hurting your ears? I hear it too, though. The word repentance is, say this with me, tshuva. Some people say teshuva. That's cool. But it's really tshuva. You're capturing the essence of what repentance is. Tshuva. It comes from the Hebrew word shuv, which means to return. But shuv means to restore something to its original origin. So to truly make repentance is to be restored back to something original. Returning back to something original. It's never really anything you say. It's something you do. So for someone to truly repent means to return to the original intent of the ways of Yah, that voice that spoke from Mount Sinai, and even going further back than that, all the way back to the Garden of Eden. All the way back. Shuv has a picture painting for us as well. Most of you are familiar with this. I didn't have it for the PowerPoint I should have put there. I get kind of mixed up with this thing sometimes. But shuv is made up of the shin, the vav, and a bet. Say shin, vav, bet. Most of you know the letters, so I'll try to express this to the best that I can. And I'll encourage you guys, there's different ways. There's people that they really focus on the pictograph and so on and so forth, which is like amazing. And pulling these and extracting these amazing things out of there. But one of the basic ways to look at the Hebrew pictures when you're examining them, get the first and the last letter of the root of a word. It's going to give you the description of everything that's going on the inside. So you have the shin, the vav, and the bet. When you look at these words, the shin speaks of to destroy, to crush some, to decrease something. The letter shin is a destructive type letter as well. It means to decrease something, and that can be good. Not always bad. All right? So it means to destroy that which hinders the house from connecting to Yah. So true repentance, shuv, means to destroy that which hinders the house of Yah from connecting with Him. So that means there's got to be a disconnection from something that you were connected to. This Hebrew word shuv is actually seen, I find this interesting, 1,339 times in the Tanakh, thanks to Esord. I don't depend fully on Esord, though. Interesting, we have a connection to Joseph's dream where his brothers would bow down to him. Remember that? They come to him and they all bow down to him. Well, what do you know? The 1,339th verse in Scripture is Genesis 44, verse 14. And it says this, "And Yehuda and his brothers came to Joseph's house, and he was still there, and they fell before him on the ground." How can that happen? I still don't know. It's just right there. I didn't make that up. That's in there. What is repentance? Repentance is the call from the prophets, and it was the word of John the Immerser to the Pharisees and the Sadducees and all of Israel. And these individuals were teaching the Torah and their traditions. And it was and always will be the call back to covenant standing. The prophets called wayward Israel back to the book of the law because that's what they were given at the time because they broke covenant with Yah creating the golden calf. So they said, you must return to the very thing that was an act of mercy or you're dead meat. That aspect of the Torah was given because you rebelled against him and it was about to be heaven on earth, but you guys screwed that up. Or can we say we did? Because we were in somebody's loins back then. Did you guys know that? We were all in somebody's loins somewhere. So we were there. If someone said, nah, I wasn't. Well, you were in the Garden of Eden because you were in the loins of Adam. So either way, you messed up. You can't run from it. So they had to return back to the book of the law the prophets were giving to them or instructing them. It is the call back to the voice of Yah, not the voice of religion or men, but the voice that spoke from Sinai and the giving of the covenant. And this part of the Torah is what liberates us from acts of rebellion. Yosef is a revealer of the secret things, and it is Yosef who has been given the ability, listen, to decipher the coded things. Remember, the coat, all the commentaries say the coats, the coat of many colors, right? Horrible translation. It was not a coat of colors. Some say, well, it was a coat of many nations. Okay, that's fine, because Israel's in the nations, right? But it was a coat of multiple prophecies. That's why the ketonet, the garment, that's the word for a high priest garment. Pasim. Pasim was an acronym for everybody that did him wrong. Remember? Yeah. So in other words, his father says, I'm giving you a garment of prophecy, Joseph. You're about to go through things you've never experienced before. Are you available? It's the same thing like the son of Elohim. He says, son, I need you to take care of something. Are you ready? Yes. It's a garment only you can wear. And its embroidery is prophetic. And it's going to contain that which you have to go through for the sake of preserving life. And it's a garment that cannot be torn apart. Just like the Messiah's garment, they didn't tear it. They preserved it. It was a royal garment. A completely royal garment. So I want to look at a few things here. Yosef is a revealer of these secret things, and it is Yosef who has been given the ability to decipher the coded things. And it was about the Egyptian, and I might be right, I was trying to really look at this, I think it was the Egyptian third dynasty of that time. There was like, I think, 18 or 19 Egyptian dynasties, something like that. But I think it was the third dynasty, that's important. Because we can, if someone says, how do you know that's true? Okay, well, let's go and look at something else, dum-dum. And let's look at these other cultures and see their writings and just kind of match it up. Well, what do you know? During the third dynasty in Egyptian hieroglyphics and information, an individual with the same type of characteristics and things that he did happened to be called Imhotep. You guys did your homework. Bill Cloud has an amazing video he did years ago on the Joseph factor. And I have those videos at home. It's two videos. Very interesting stuff. And I first heard that when I saw that. I was like, that's interesting. I'm going to look that up. Imhotep was a man's name, a certain individual. And I want to just kind of give you some examples of Joseph and this guy, Imhotep, during the third dynasty in the time that Egypt was ruling. All right. Both of these individuals were second in command to Pharaoh, Joseph and this individual Imhotep, both of them. Both lived to be 110 years old. Both were great architects and builders. Both stored up grain for a seven-year famine. You can check it out yourself. Both saw the seven-year famine coming and they prepared ahead of time. Both were dream interpreters. Both were able to heal the sick. Both instituted an income tax of one-fifth. Both married into the priesthood of On, who is what? Heliopolis. The same thing. Go figure. Both had knowledge of astrology and astronomy. Both were educated writers. Both came from a family of 12 siblings, counting themselves. And there's many other parallels with these individuals. I find that fascinating. Many other. Can you guys see this? Kind of blurry, huh? But this is the hieroglyphics for Zaphna Paneach, right? And notice, for those that are into the ancient Hebrew, the pictures, the paleo, right? Notice in the hieroglyphics of the Egyptian writings, we have what looks similar to a bet. And that's placed inside for that who refers to Joseph. I find that interesting. Imhotep means he who comes in peace. Fascinating. He who comes in peace. So let's look at Zaphna Paneach real quick, and then we're going to get into these things here. Zaphna Paneach. Can you guys say that? It's really Zaphnat Paneach. And I did want to look at this because it has the same equivalence to the Hebrew word Megale Mesutarim, which means this, revealer of things that have been hidden. So Zaphna Paneach is also equivalent numerically to the phrase for one who reveals hidden things. And when you break down Zaphna Paneach, you have Sofan, which means concealed. It's also like the word for north, right? The concealed place. It says that when King David would try to sleep, it said this wind would come from the north and blow across his harp. And he would come up with these beautiful psalms and begin to write them. King David wrote almost 5,000 psalms. Not just the 150 in the King James Version or in our scriptures or the Sefer. No, he wrote almost 5,000 psalms. It's a lot of writing. It's a lot of singing. Imagine writing over 5,000 songs. Wow. What a heart. What a heart this King David had. That's amazing. So Sofan, as you guys could see, means conceal or hidden. You have the Hebrew word po, which means hunger, to hunger for or to groan. And then you have the last letters of Neach, which is Noach, which means rest. So embedded in the name given to him is actually a message, which is this: the hunger for the rest that has been hidden. So Joseph, who is Zaphna Paneach, is going to bring about what? The rest that people been hungering for. What were they hungering for? His brothers were hungering for peace for the first time. What are people looking for in the Middle East right now? Peace in the Middle East. But it's going to be a deceptive type of peace that is presented. There's going to be a false Joseph that rises up as always a counterfeit what the enemy does. All the time. All the time. People are wondering, what does the Antichrist look like? Who cares? If you had to pick what he looked like from what he does, focus on what he does. That'll let you know exactly who he is. Who cares what he looks like? Oh, he's Mexican, or he's black, or he's white, or he's this. Who cares who he is? We need to be preparing ourselves for the coming of our Mashiach and not be worried about all these other things going on. There's a rest that awaits the people of Yah, a rest that surpasses all understanding, a love that has no comparison. This word literally means one who decodes secrets. Tzafan is the Hebrew word that means a decipher of secrets. Tzafnat, you can look at this, means one who knows how to decipher or divide the Tav, which is covenant. Divide the very word of Yah properly. Joseph has the anointing to rightly divide the word of truth. To say, get your rabbinics out that are contaminating people. 1,184 commands now for Shabbat? Where the heck did that come from? You can't even breathe. When there's only about six or seven actual commands pertaining to Shabbat in Scripture, and it makes it more peaceful to embrace. We have to be able to rightly divide between what is for us now and what is no longer for us anymore. Because heaven spoke, you guys. We kind of beat this horse over and over and over again. Heaven spoke the year Mashiach rose from the dead. You guys know that, right? The throne of a voice, if we can say, came forth from the throne. And it was this. After that Passover, right? Mashiach raises up from the dead during the Feast of First Fruits, right? Stays with the disciples for about 42 days total, really. And then the wait in Jerusalem, 8 days later, Shavuot, right? Shavuot comes and it's gone. You have the counting of the Omer in the midst of that, right? And then you have the building up to the coming Moedim in the fall. While the religious men are preparing Yom Kippur, everybody's there. All of them. And for the first time in history, they roll the dice. Come on, seven. No, they roll the lots. They use a specific way for these lots, black stone, white stone. And guess what? A specific stone would no longer end up in the hand of the high priest anymore. No longer would the menorah light, the western Shamish branch, which is really the central branch that supplies. Someone say western branch. It's really the Shamish branch, right? Which means servant branch that supplied the rest of the oil for the other branches. In other words, the servant branch has the discernment for the proper anointing for the other branches that is needed. It no longer stood lit anymore. Those massive doors, remember, for those of you that don't know, there's a few of you in here that don't know. Those massive doors kept blowing open every night, and it took 20 plus strong Levites to close them. They blew open every night. Flies started to show up on the Temple Mount. And the goat for Azazel kept returning to Jerusalem. Remember how we like reenacted? I was doing something up here. I forgot what I did. The goat's just walking right back into Jerusalem, carrying all the sin of Israel, right? And the priest of that time was not even a son of Aaron, so he was contaminated anyways, especially with what was going on in Jerusalem. Nothing worked anymore. Heaven no longer accepted that. Well, that happened 1 year. No, that happened for 40 years in a row. And in 70 AD, the temple was destroyed. And if there was another 70 years, it would have been another 70 years not accepted. So if Yahweh was no longer accepting certain things anymore, then that means there's been a change of something that is embedded in the Torah. That we, as Joseph, have to rightly divide. And what do you know? You don't see Yom Kippur in the future anymore. You don't see it anymore. We can still do, we have a Yom Kippur, but we show the work of Mashiach during Yom Kippur. We're not bringing a rabbinic thing and all this other stuff. No, we're showing the work of Mashiach. He is our atonement, as the scripture says. There was so much that had gone on, and it is Joseph's duty to rightly divide between the word. It is our responsibility. all of our responsibility as Yosef. So you could see that Zaphnat is one who what? Deciphers the secrets of the covenant. Zaphnat can read a decipher between royal covenant and law that's imposed on the people. Paneach has more to it than meets the eye. The value of 208, which is the same as Isaac and Hagar, the son of promise and the woman of the flesh from below. Paul Shaul uses that analogy when he's bringing a distinction between covenant relationship and imposing something because of rebellion. We have to rightfully divide it. And it, you know, this rubs people the wrong way. And I know there's teachers out there that promote the covenant things and the difference between these two things, and they kind of throw everything out. No, I know that in the midst of the tabernacle, the midst of the sacrificial system, the hand of mercy was extended from the throne. And the Father says, you have to come this way, because that's the second thing in this world that has authority beneath Adam. So because of that fall, the next kingdom is the animal kingdom that is innocent. So you're going to have to take the innocence of that blood in order just to come close to me, but never to come into my dwelling, only to come from a distance. You're going to use it. I'm going to teach you how to approach me through an animal sacrificial system that was never intended, but you'll learn how to come close to me. And you'll learn this all through the tabernacle. I'm going to give you these things as an act of mercy. Mercy is extended to a rebellious people. Chen, grace, if I can use that term, is extended to those who are walking out what the Father says already. Because grace is the strength and empowerment to keep the tent up. Chen comes from Chanan, which means to pitch a tent. So grace is what? The strength to keep your tent up so that he dwells in your life. That's what grace really is. It's not this unmerited favor thing that we hear. It's beyond that. That's like abstract to the bone. Grace is pitching a tent and saying, here I am, my house is ready. Can you dwell with me now? That's really what that is. We need to understand a whole lot. We're in the season to decode the difference between the Melech Tzedek and that of the Levitical system being set up today. I get the emails already, and I even had the little arguments with a couple, you know, decent, respectful arguments between, you know, a well-known name everybody here knows. I'm not even going to say it. We have each other's personal number, and there's a difference, you know, and that's fine. But you know what? It's either or. Bottom line. Mashiach or something that they're doing in Jerusalem today. I want to follow the Messiah. I do. As you can notice that we're trying to what? Decipher this Egyptian person, ourselves, who is really Joseph. Judah is now standing before his brother Joseph, but he thinks it's some Egyptian king. Why? The reason today for our brother Judah rejecting Yeshua or Yahushua is because men have dressed up Joseph as some Gentile king, and this doesn't make Yehuda jealous or cause Yehuda to see Joseph or Yeshua, Mashiach, Ben Joseph, for who he really is. He can attach Christmas trees, wreaths, and Easter baskets to Yeshua and say, we celebrate this day because of his birth and resurrection. All of that's wrong. It doesn't work. These have nothing to do with the Mashiach. They have never had anything to do with him. And it is when Yehuda realizes who Yosef is that he completes the process of repentance. And this is why in the Melech Tzedek priesthood, we have the distinction and revelation of the true Mashiach, the true Messiah, the true high priest that we're to be following. Is it kind of warm in here? You guys feel good? So remember I mentioned he called them spies, right? Meraglim atem. Say that. Meraglim atem. Surely you are spies. Look at the word for spies is an acronym for what they did. Because he said that to them and they felt bad. And you can find that in Genesis 42:16. The mem of meraglim is the Hebrew word mivne, which means from the sons. The resh is Rachel. The gimel is ganav, which means to kidnap. The lamed is the Hebrew word lakochot, which means to sell or sold. The yud of meraglim is the yishmaelim, the Ishmaelites. The mem, the final mem of meraglim is Mitzrayimah, which is Egypt. So embedded in the word for you are surely spies is actually a phrase that Joseph's using. He's saying this. It was from the sons of Rachel, which was Joseph, right? That a theft or kidnapping took place. And it was Joseph who was sold to the Ishmaelites and sent down into Mitzrayim. So he's saying, you guys are spies. You're the ones that took one of the sons of Rachel, Joseph, and did what? Kidnapped, threw in a pit, in whom the Ishmaelites wound up selling to Mitzrayim. You can only see it in Hebrew. When Judah repents and pleads with Joseph on behalf of a father who has already lost a child dear to his heart, things will happen. Is this an end time picture of the repentance of the Yehudim? Yes, it is. It's an end time picture. We talked about, or we had in the beginning, the reuniting. These are subjects here. The reuniting of the lost family members. Healing and reuniting divided families and homes. Recognition and reconciliation. Forgiveness of past wrongs, offenses, and misunderstandings. How many in here today can relate to one or more of these areas? Some, we can relate to some of them or one of them. It is, and it always has been, about the reuniting of the divided house of Israel. Always. The name of the Torah portion is Vayigash, which comes from Nagash, right? It means to come near. It means a person or a place, to come near to a person or to a place for whatever reason. And interesting, this word is seen in Ezekiel 44:13 with the Levites that are not allowed to approach or come near because of their idolatrous practices. And it is also another form to approach in prayer. And I want to ask you guys, what is prayer? What is prayer? Is it just saying a bunch of words? I really want to encourage you guys with something. And some people get scared with this word, but you don't have to, because it's everywhere in the scriptures. Meditate upon the word. Find one word and concentrate on that. Meditate on that word from the scriptures. And watch what he shows you. Tap into that deep, and I'm going to say it because it's real, that deep inner conscious state of your soul. Not what the New Agers are doing. They stole things that are ancient and scriptural. That's why the scripture says to meditate upon his word day and night. All day long, meditate on it. Day and night. We need to learn how to be still. And I've done this with men in the past. A few men, we'd come together to pray, and I wouldn't say anything. I'd be quiet for about 15 minutes. Not even praying in tongues or doing whatever, or quoting a verse, nothing. I'm like being broad, okay? Nothing, saying nothing, and I did this. I look up, and they're looking at me. And I say this to them. Keep your eyes closed and just wait. We need to learn how to wait and be patient and watch what will happen. My family and I, we've been practicing this at home. You know, not to brag and say, look at us. No, because all hell breaks loose once you start practicing these things. So it's like, be ready. Get ready, because it's going to happen. We practice the fasting, the praying, and the meditating, being still. Excuse me. And not saying anything. At our table, just silent, and everybody knows. And all of a sudden, it's like a wind comes in our home. I'm not kidding. And the Ruach moves on one of them, on my son or one of my daughters or my wife or me. And it's like we lose track of time. And the Father begins to minister in areas and begins to show us things as a family. We need to learn. I don't know why I'm stuck on that. I mentioned to my wife, I said, I'm just stuck on prayer, which is a good thing. Seriously, stuck on being still. Be still and know that I am Yah. Be still and know. Turn everything off and be still and come to the place of knowing. There's a phrase, and King David knew something. And he wrote in Psalms 109, verse 4, Va'ani tefila. I love this phrase. This is powerful. And you guys already know that embedded in Adam, when you spell Adam out in full, embedded in Adam, you and I, is the word mitpalel. Anybody know what that means? Mitpalel. You guys know what that means? It means one who prays. So when you spell out Adam's name in full, you spell the Aleph out, the Dalet out, and the Mem out in full. The first letters is Adam. The rest of the letters spells out Mitpalel, which means one who prays. The Father embedded in Adam the power of prayer. We can't just talk about it. We have to do it. How many people are willing to say, you know what? I don't care what time of the day it is. Let's just do this. I don't care how tired I am. Let's just be still and know that we are to become. You know, we are to become prayer. We are to become, like my youngest daughter, she says, I am to become a walking fast. I looked at her like, oh my gosh. That is powerful. She's told that to Jared. She said, I'm to become a walking fast. Something's happening with the young children right now. The youth. They're abstaining from the fleshly desires to a certain degree, right? We need to live eating, right? But there's a pull. It's like the Ruach is pulling this generation. And we as parents better be sensitive to what that means. We better know how to interpret that type of garment. Prayer is powerful. You know what? Try doing this. I did this. Not to brag, but to say, you know what? To show how real and how human I am and how desirous I wanted the Father to do something. I went on a 6-day fast with no water, no food. That's big for me. Nothing. The first 3 days, my lips were cracking. It was horrible physically. And then at the sixth day, I needed this. There was something the Father did in our whole life as a family back then, and He did it. I said, I am not putting anything in my mouth until you answer me. Nothing. I'm staying right here. I'm not even going to work. Nothing. I'm not moving from this closet until you step into our life and do something, Father. That means if I'm going to physically die, that means I'm going to be with you sooner and I won't be able to finish anything you wanted me to do here. I can't do it in heaven. I need you to do something. And you know what? He did it. If we can just be still and wait upon Him, we'll understand what Psalm 109, verse 4, part B, the last phrase of that says this. I want you guys to say it. Va'ani. Tefila. And if you read in the King James, it says, and I give myself to prayer. See, the translators didn't even understand that. Let's keep it real and the way it's supposed to be. That phrase says, and I am prayer. Va'ani means and I. Tefila, prayer. And I am prayer. We need to become people of prayer. Forget all this weird stuff. We need to learn how to pray. We need to learn how to be centered. You got people that are hurt because of church settings. And you know what? I don't want to touch the gifts anymore. I don't think that's for today. It's just like weird now. You know what? I'm going this other direction. And this other stuff seems really better. You know, the Davidic dances on. That's fine too then. But we need to become a people of power. Yes. A people of prayer walking the Torah out and being Joseph and having the influence that no one else has but Joseph. Joseph understood because he spent time in a deep pit with no water. He became the water of the pit. There was no bread. He became the bread of the pit. My tears I drink every day, what the psalmist is really saying. As my strength withers away, that is my food daily. We need to understand and discern where our true strength comes from as the people of Yah. How many people would dare say, Father, throw me in a pit and teach me what it means to drink of the waters of the supernatural? When everybody else around is looking inside that pit and saying, why is he rejoicing? Why is she rejoicing? All hell is around them. Don't you observe the Torah? Aren't you Sabbath? Aren't you a Shomer Shabbat? You can share that with those, the Jewish brethren that, you know, I've done this. You share it, the ones that sell like the Dead Sea salts. And they're trying to get you over, right? And they speak Hebrew, everything well. Ask those, not to judge them, but ask them. Just say, are you a Shomer Shabbat? Are you a guardian of the Sabbath? And a conviction comes for them to return back to the ways of old. But we need to be people that can discern what's really going on in our lives. Joseph has the power to decipher the encoded things of the Torah, not just quote them, not just evangelize people in the same building, not just keep going to the kind, there's blessings to go to conferences, of course, but not just be around the same people. You know what? Going out. Fathers, take your family. We do this with ours and evangelize people. Go out and share the good news and show acts of kindness. Me and my family, we do that. We don't talk about it. That's just something we do. We need to put feet, boots to the Torah, arms and legs to this walk, and really do what he says to do. Not just tickle each other's shoes or feet, if I could say that. So Yehuda, he came near to him and said what? He came near and said, there's coming a day when Yehuda will seek out Yosef and speak to him. And this type of language used here goes beyond the material or physical realm. Judah has now come to a place outside of the way he has been doing things all along. True repentance is when we come to the end of ourselves and have now been placed upon the road of reconciliation. The divided house of Israel will be reconciled, so it is time to put all things into proper perspective. The church didn't have everything wrong, but yet we throw the baby out with the bathwater. There's that narrow path we're supposed to walk on. And the scripture goes on to say, O my master, which we read, please let your servant speak a word in my master's hearing, and do not let your displeasure burn against your servant, for you are like Pharaoh. My master asked his servant, saying, have you a father or a brother? And we said to my master, we have a father who's an old man and a child of his old age. The same phrase used for Joseph back in 37, verse 3. And you know what's interesting? I just happened to look at this. In Genesis chapter 37, verse 3, all the way up to this verse right here, happens to be 259 verses. You guys ever do that? I don't want to be religious. I have never been a religious guy. I want to remain down to earth, rooted and grounded in him, but touching this planet, being available for everyone that's around. But I do like to go into the deep end of things and look at stuff. So I counted the verses. There happens to be 259 verses between this comment of Judah and Joseph being the child of his father's old age. Both of them meaning that Jacob poured into Joseph. Jacob poured into Benjamin. Jacob spent time pouring into his children, specifically Joseph and Benjamin, which is being spoken of right here. But 259 verses between these two. Well, what do you know? Look at this. Excuse me. 259 gives us a Hebrew phrase, Seba Yosef Malchi. Yosef the Malchi has come to be revealed. So in 259 verses between these two comments is when Joseph will begin to reveal himself. And it's just like when Judah comes to the place of recognizing who Joseph really is through repentance, that Joseph will say, I am Yosef, Ani Yosef. I am Joseph. I am your brother. 259 also equals the Hebrew word ba'aron, which means in the ark. What was inside of the ark were the covenant stones, was the covenant relationship between Israel and Yahweh himself. So let me go ahead here. Just look at that for a minute. That phrase where it talks about Joseph revealing himself, when you read this whole thing backwards, this is amazing with Hebrew. It gives us, I want you guys to repeat that. I even put the transliteration up here for you guys. So I want you guys to say it as a group. When you read that phrase of Joseph revealing himself, it is at, when you read it in reverse, it's the phrase, the bringing together of the divided house by pure light. So Joseph's bones that were placed in the ark would be also buried in exile, Mitzrayim, until the coming of Israel's deliverance. And then the scripture says, because they're saying, he says, take my bones out of here. And his brother is dead, the scripture goes on. And he alone is left of his mother's children. They thought Joseph was dead, right? And his father loves him. At this point, Judah is convinced that Joseph is dead. But little does he know that the one who was once dead in his eyes has risen to power. So there's going to come a time where Judah will admit, yes, this man died. And as the prophets say, he's going to go to the Yehudim, right? Or the Yahudim. And they're going to look at the holes in his hands and they're going to say, where did you get that from? I got these in the house of my friends. How many friends do you have that would do something like that to you? There are people that are out there like that though. But he reveals himself like this. Look at the scars of my hands. I got these in the house of my friends. Verse 21 of chapter 44, it says, and you said to your servants, bring him down to me and let me set my eyes on him. Within Judaism, it is believed that when we all obey and observe the Torah according to their rabbinic law, then the Mashiach will come down and set up his kingdom. Is this how you bring down the Messiah, by observing rabbinic law? No, it is not. Obedience to the covenant at Sinai is our goal. And note, it is Yehuda who is commanded and has the responsibility of bringing down the son of the right hand, Benjamin. Judah is commanded to usher in Benjamin, which means son of the right hand. Judah has the responsibility of ushering in the son of the right hand. But this is not the case today. There are many beautiful things that can be gleaned from the insights of the rabbis when it comes to life and study. But when Torah is given a detour from its rightful place by the hands of religious men, then it becomes a serious problem. When the narrow path of covenant is exchanged for rabbinic authority and genealogical rights, then you can know for a certain that it is not what royal covenant Torah has instructed for us. There's one master and one emunah, one faith, not many. And how is the son supposed to return? When we as the whole house of Israel return to the covenant Torah as was intended at Mount Sinai. With the Melech Tzadik as our leader and chief commander, then the situation in the land and the world today will cease to exist. And remember, Joseph and Benjamin both represent the first and the second coming of the Mashiach. You have Joseph. He represents the first coming of the Messiah. And Benjamin represents the second coming of the Messiah. And both of them that are key. I want to show you guys because there's some beautiful things. Look at this here. When you look at the last two words from last week. Right here. And the two first Hebrew words. I want to give you these treasures because they're beautiful. Beginning in this week. Combined, it says this, right? Your father and he approached. But embedded in this, look at this, is a historical account with Judah and the father combining and bringing about the word shalom. You see the highlighted letters? It spells shalom. So when you're connected to the father, and when Judah approaches like he's supposed to, it's going to bring about the right peace or the right shalom. From Hebrew, the hieroglyphics, we have the essence of what shalom is. And here I did put it. Here's what shalom is. This is shalom, right? To destroy the chaos caused by false shepherd men. To destroy the chaos caused by false shepherd men. Shalom. True peace comes when you destroy the doctrines of men. How do you destroy the doctrines of men? When you begin to walk out what his word says. Shalom. That's shalom for you guys, for whatever that's worth. After Judah offers to be the guarantor of his brother Benjamin, Jacob gives him the following charge, and it says this, and may El Shaddai grant you chesed before the man, that he may release to you your other brother, which was Simeon, as well as Benjamin. So look at this phrase right here. This is amazing. Embedded in this phrase here, we have Ve'el Shaddai Yiten Lachem Rachamim Lifnei Ha'ish Ve'shilach. In Hebrew, which says this whole sentence here, but notice embedded in the phrase Rachamim, and this man will release in your face, we have the word Mashiach. Embedded in this phrase, we have the word, the one who holds the power of release is the actual Mashiach. And he alone sends out and releases those that are in bondage. Is that too much for some of you? No? All right. How many people knew that? Only in the Hebrew is such a beautiful language, and you can find so many things embedded like this inside of this beautiful language at these perfect space distances. No coincidence. How many people have dreams? Wasn't Joseph one who interpreted dreams? So look at this. Yosef is to interpret the dream, and we as Yosef are to interpret the dream also. Interpreting dreams is to become what? A master of time. When you master your time, you can become the interpreter of dreams. But too many are wasting time and filling in time with stuff that is just not good for you. I'll leave it at that. Being a master of time is one who will be able to interpret dreams. We master our time by making time our servant. Yosef did this, and we must do the same. Yosef made the hurt of his brothers his hurts. The failures of his brothers, his failures. The loneliness and regret of his brothers, his own. Yosef has made himself available to redeem his brothers. And this is all seen in the word chalam, dreams. Yosef is the interpreter and therefore the savior. The word for dream and garment are actually connected. The word for garment and dream are connected. Joseph's the interpreter of a dream, which is also the same for the word to sew garments together. The Hebrew word for sew is tofer. Can you say tofer? It means to sew or to stitch garments together. Now look at this. It means to connect garments and make them one. To build and give understanding is also tofer. When you rearrange those letters of tofer, you have patar, which means to interpret. So Joseph is one who knew how to woven the garments together to bring understanding. To interpret a dream is to be like one who can put garments together and give understanding of the dream. Anybody interpret dreams in here? Do you guys see what's happening right now? I'm mentioning things as the Father was giving them to me to activate your gifts that are inside of you. This is not just for the sake of touching on, sharing on things. This is to activate your own gifts. You know why? I'm going to say it. Within the Messianic and Hebrew roots movement, it's become like a plug. And I'm going to say it because I know all these leaders. I know them. And I know how it goes. The Messianic and Hebrew roots as a whole has become like a plug over the well. Because there's more to the Torah. There's a lot more to the Torah than just what is written. It's time to remove those things, to dig, to remove that which has covered up the wells. So that's why I'm asking, you know what? How many people here were raised in the church? Raise your hand. How many people just never went to church and came straight into the Hebrew roots, Messianic roots? Raise your hand. There's some there. How many people just have no idea why they're here today? How many people are just relaxed? I'm just kidding. I love you guys, man. I can play with you guys. We're all children of Yah, so I like to play sometimes. But I guarantee you, every one of you in here has a gift. Everyone, there's someone in here that knows how to interpret dreams. There is someone here who has a prophetic gift on them, a mantle. There is someone here who can interpret languages, probably all over the world. There is someone who has the discerning of spirits here. My prayer before I came here today was, Father, activate the gifts in your children so that we can truly be a people of power. So wherever you are today, whatever your gifting is, my prayer is that that would be activated full capacity before this Shabbat is completely over. I'm really speaking from my Ruach. Really. I put something up on Facebook because I was meditating on the letter Mem. One letter for like 4 hours, just constantly going over in my mind. I'm not kidding. The letter Mem. Mem represents water, a womb, and all these things, right? But if you notice, water is a metaphor for the Torah. Living waters, right? And so much more. Do you guys ever notice that water is always seeking lower ground? It doesn't see, rivers don't flow upstream. I know the Mississippi River reversed itself. I'm not talking about that. But rivers don't flow up. They go with the gravitational pull and they seek lower ground. And I was meditating upon that, that if we can make ourselves humble, there is an energy that will draw down the living waters from above into our life. But we have to be that low place. in order for that to come alive and be real. When we humble ourselves, an energy is birthed. And that's when those living waters from above begin to descend down and take residence in the lowest places of our life. We need to become like that. And that was a meditation for me this way. I was thinking about that. I said, we need to humble ourselves so that those living waters can truly come forth. See, when the Messiah was giving the Beatitudes, remember that? Guess who he was speaking about? He was speaking about, I can give you the material on it. He was speaking to those who he grew up with in the Qumran community, which were humble people, which were people that knew about fasting and prayer, which were people, believe it or not, were vegetarian and probably even vegans. They begin to abstain from the meat sacrificed to idols. Shaul was convicting the religious people in the temple that had their sodomite booths up on top and all this other stuff. He was convicting them by saying these terms also. Meats sacrificed unto idols. Not just in the nations, now they're doing it here in Jerusalem. So the Qumran community said, you know what? We're not going to eat of anything that comes off that altar. Because once you partake of something, you elevate that up into the heavens because we've been given the key to unlock things here. When we can do what is right and lower ourselves low, we will understand more of the Torah than we know today. We have to become that low place. We have to become humble because then what the Father will lift us up and raise us up to higher places in Him. So the Messiah, when he's speaking about the Beatitudes, read them now. It's all pertaining to fasting and prayer. I think it was Craig Peters. I had a conversation with him. Anybody know Craig Peters? He fasts and prays. A wonderful guy, right? Has different views on different things. It's cool. But he fasts and prays all the time. And when you look at those terms in the Beatitudes, those are the characteristics of those who fast and pray. We need to be people of fasting and prayer. I don't know why I'm stuck on this. This is just really something. Me and my family have been talking about this last week, all this week. We've been doing it, and there's been something powerful in our home. We need to become people of fasting and prayer and take that home. What do they say? That's real talk, right? I don't even know what they say today. I lose track of what they do. I'm going to close just with this little bit here, and then I'm going to stop. I have much more, but we're going to pray today. We're going to really pray today, okay? So Yosef is one who sews together that which has been torn apart, and it is time for Yosef to sew together that which has been torn apart. Families have been torn apart. And everything seems to be normal, but it's not. There's a few of you in here today where you're trying to make it seem like it's okay, and it is all jacked up. But today, I know. I don't think and I don't feel. I know that Abba has given an anointing for us in here today that breaks yokes of bondage, but to help put and sew the pieces back together. And we're going to pray today. Congregations have been torn apart because of jealousy. You got people jealous. You know, here's me. When that rises up, I say, here, take it. You're good. I don't need it. I'm not looking for that. I'll sit right here. That's why we have men getting up, and there's someone that has something that's supposed to be here. Like next week, we're going to have a man share an amazing word. I know when to get the heck out the way. It's not about me. People make it about themselves. Joseph knows how to be still and wait. Jealous people want to be up and seen in front of everyone, and they want everything for themselves, and you better not say, oh, what did they say over there? Well, let me tell you this. I don't play that. You know what? Whatever. That causes injury and hurt. And congregation, because of that, congregations have been torn apart because of jealousy. And then people's lives that have been damaged, they suppress those things and they push them way down. And no healing ever takes place. But today, you know what? Don't leave here today without being prayed for. Seriously. I do not want to be the congregation out there that does everything that everybody else is doing. I want to be sensitive to the Ruach HaKodesh, our helper, and flow. We've seen a lot of healings already in the past couple of weeks where everybody's come up for prayer. And a few of you, the Father has instructed me to share something I don't know nothing about in your ear that was for you and for your family. And it was exactly right on what he said, what he intended and what was going on. Lives have been damaged severely, because of those who walk in the spirit of selfish and controlling spirits. Be still and know that he is Yah. And there's some in here today who might be afraid to come out from the place of safety, safe havens. Remember, the pit of Yosef at first was lonely, but after a while, it seemed like a safe haven. Pits of pain are not safe havens, but pits can be filled with living water. Pits of pain are destructive and constricting, and you must come out of that pit of pain before you are blinded and see it as a safe haven. I want everybody to close their eyes. Yosef, arise, because you have been anointed by Yahweh for this very assignment. Yosef, arise, you have been anointed by Yahweh for this very assignment. Bring the dream to the place of unity, Yosef. And it's time for Yosef to sew together the misunderstandings even of the priesthoods. It's time for Yosef to sew together the torn garment of the whole house of Israel. And it's time for Yosef to sew together the lives that have been torn apart by the wild beasts of envy and hatred, especially in the Hebrew Roots movement. Yosef, arise to your place of power and anointing that breaks the yoke of bondage. Father, I don't know what's going on. You messed me all up today. Nothing in order the way I put it down. But everything that you want is to happen today, Abba. So, Father, right now, as your children's eyes are closed, I pray that every mind would be at ease. That any kind of religious spirit, if there's anything like that in here, I don't really sense that. But if there's one that is hidden, may that be at ease. May we all be still right now and know that you are Yah. Abba, I pray that the gifts of your people would be reactivated that have been dormant. I pray for healing right now, Father, emotionally, mentally, physically. Father, those shepherds out there, those shepherdesses, those that are in some form of leader position that might have hurt people in here today or even watching. Father, I pray that scars, wounds, Father, would be completely healed. That your people would be set free today, Abba, that might be struggling in some areas. Even those deep personal areas that no one knows about. Father, I pray that you set free that man and that woman from that struggle. From that struggle, Father, that brings about a weighty unworthiness in their mind. Set them free, Father. I thank you. Father, I pray, and we all come in agreement, I pray for the Messianic Hebrew roots communities worldwide, that all the strife and backbiting and Leviathan-type characteristics and Jezebel nonsense would come to an end. That you would raise up shepherds after your own heart. As you said in Jeremiah chapter 3, backsliding Israel has shown herself more righteous than treacherous Judah. Go and proclaim these words to the north and say, return, O backsliding Israel, declares Yahweh, and I shall not look on you in displeasure, for I am kind, declares Yahweh, and I do not bear a grudge forever. Only acknowledge your crookedness, because you have transgressed against Yahweh your Elohim, and have scattered your ways to strangers and under every green tree. And you have not obeyed my voice, declares Yahweh. Return, O backsliding children, declares Yahweh. For I shall rule over you and shall take you one from a city and two from a clan, and I shall bring you to Zion. And I shall give you shepherds according to my heart, and they shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. And it shall be when you have increased and shall bear fruit in the land in those days, declares Yahweh, that they no longer say, the ark of the covenant of Yahweh. Neither would it come to heart, nor would they remember it, nor would they visit it, nor would it be made again. At that time, Yerushalayim shall be called the throne of Yah, and all the nations shall be gathered to it, to the name of Yahweh, to Jerusalem, and no longer walk after the stubbornness of their evil hearts. In those days, the house of Judah shall go to the house of Israel, and they shall come together out of the land of the north to the land that I have given as an inheritance. So, Father, we pray for that restoration for all of Israel worldwide, for everyone that's in here, all of those that might be watching, Father. Cause us to be a people of power, of fasting and prayer, so that we can be fit vessels for the Master's use. Father, turn the pits of pain into pits of power filled with living water. I want everybody to stand up real quick. Just stand up. Don't even think about it. Just stand up. And if you're struggling in any type of constricted way, I want you to come up here. Don't even think about it. Come all the way up here. Don't think. Don't hesitate. Don't let the enemy lie to you. If you're struggling, if there's something, if the garment has been torn apart at home, come on up. If the marriage is really not there, but you came in with the biggest smile on the planet, get on up here. We don't want to leave the same. We've been taking these baby steps for the past 4 weeks now, barely touching the Torah portion and getting into the personal lives of all of us here. Because the Father is using this small congregation as an avenue to bring about something greater that has been dormant for a long time. People of power walking in the full manifestation of the Ruach HaKodesh, observant of His covenant Torah and His Sabbaths and His Moedim and Koshrut, all of those things, a full, complete body and people of power. I want you all to lift your hands up. No, we're not going to do no charismatic Pentecostal thing here. But we are going to pray. Because it's the Master's touch. It's the Master's touch. Husbands, hold your wives' hands as tight as you can. Husbands, if your wives are up here and you're back in that pew, that seat, you need to be right up here because both of you are one flesh. And grab a hold of your wife. Grab a hold of husbands. If you're here by yourself, wife, if you're sitting in that chair, get on up here. Father, I thank you that you hear us when we pray. Merciful Father, Abba, you hear your people when they cry. Abba, we're trying to walk this walk out, and it seems like times are getting harder and harder. Things just didn't go completely the way they should have this week, and we might have said things we shouldn't have said, did things we shouldn't have done. Abba, we are so sorry. We've caused hurt to our spouse, to our wife and our husband or our children. We did some things, said some things, thought some things, struggled with some things that we did not really want to do. And we found ourselves trapped in those things. So, Abba, I thank you now. As you hear me when I'm praying, Father, that your hand of rachamim, you are so merciful. You are long-suffering. You are so forgiving, Father, and you love your children. That it is not the will of you for many to perish, but for all to come to repentance, to Teshuvah. So, Father, I pray even now that you would begin to touch every man, woman, and child here. Every marriage, every husband, every wife, every father, every mother, every grandmother, every grandfather. Father, we don't want to leave the same. So I ask, Abba, that you would begin now to reactivate the things of that have been dormant. Reactivate your gifts. Loose that spirit, Abba, we ask, that has been in chains. Break all chains of bondage and barriers that have kept them from running in the fullness of their ruach, of their spirit that you intended them to run in. Father, let that fresh blowing of your spirit flow through this place, Father. We're not a religion. We are a people of power and passion for your truth and for your word. All demonic activities that have lied to your people and have come in the name of Yahushua, Yahuwah, HaMashiach, by the power of your blood, let those things be broken off of those that have come in bondage. I say, loose that tongue. Loose that song. Loose that word. Let it come forth and bubble out of your stomach and sing the praises of Yah. Praise the praises of Yah and begin to walk in the strength and the power of the reality of this Torah. We thank you. We put on notice every demon and every dark force, every chant and every demonic prayer that has come against your people. We render it as Joseph, broken and severed and taking no root in our lives anymore. You cannot have anything. Religious spirits of false shepherds. We just pray and we thank you, Father, that those things are broken. Those soul ties of people that have been there. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, I pray for a spiritual abortion to take place in that. You are to bear the word of his truth, not to bear the word of some man and some woman. To bear the word of truth and power. For the Father has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and of a sound, disciplined mind. Father, I pray that your men would learn how to be submissive to your authority, Father. Not to religious men. That the men will love their wives the way the Mashiach loved his wife and laid his life down. And that the women would rise up with the greatest honor and respect to treat their husbands like your word says. So, Father, I thank you now. I thank you that you hear us when we pray. I don't need to go around and lay hands on people and all that. You guys are being touched by the Ruach HaKodesh. Father, I pray now, and I'm really pushing this. Remove all doubt from whoever's doubting right now. There's few of you doubting. It's all right. It's okay. Be at peace. Be at shalom. Don't doubt him. Don't doubt what he has for you. It's okay. He knows everything that happened. He knows everything that happened. He knows the fears that were there, that tried to be. He knows it's okay. He's here to take all of that today. You're not going to leave the same way. You're going to leave rejoicing and jumping and praising his set apart name. Let Yahweh arise and his enemies be completely scattered by the power of the name of Yahweh. Hallelujah. We thank you, Abba. We're not leaving. There's still a couple of you that there's a fear in you. You're holding on to it. It already let go. You're holding on to it. Let it go. That's not you. That's not your garment. That doesn't belong in your life. You're afraid to step out. Don't be afraid. Step out and risk looking like the biggest fool in the world. I've done it all on camera. Do it. We have nothing to lose and everything to gain. Step on out. Let those gifts explode through your people, Abba. Let the church see what is this that has risen up. Ani HaYosef. We are Joseph. Hallelujah. We are Joseph. We are Joseph. We thank you, Abba. I thank you, Abba, that you are comforting your children right now. That you are comforting all your people right now. Where the Spirit of Yahuwah is, there is Yovelim. There are freedoms. There are jubilees, freedoms. Breathe in the freedom that He has. Breathe in the freedom that He's given you. Breathe in the freedom. Exhale the bondage. Exhale the doubt. Exhale the hurt. Exhale the fear. Exhale the past. It's not the past is gone now. Exhale those things. Walk in the newness of your life. Father, give that man and that woman greater wisdom and knowledge. Let that gift of chokmah and binah, Father, that building power to be implanted in their mind. Those spaces that have been vacated right now, Father, fill them up so there's no room for the enemy. I thank you, Abba. Let there be a fresh release of your Ruach on all levels today. Those that are called to lead, let them step forth and lead. Those that are called to serve, let them step forth and serve. Those that are called to give of everything of their life, let them give of everything of their life. Those who are called to do kingdom work, let them come forth. That ministry is not dead yet. Your calling in your life is not dead yet. Your calling in your life is just beginning. What Yahweh has begun, He will finish until the coming of Mashiach. We're not dead, we're alive, and we're well. Your Ruach is filling your people up. I thank you, Abba. Hallelujah. We're not subject to no Pharaoh. We don't fear no government powers. We're not afraid of no messianic maniac. We're not afraid of no Islamic terrorist. We are not afraid of no taskmasting pastor. We're not afraid of religion. We are not subject to the powers of this world. For we are pilgrims passing through this place. Oh, hallelujah, Father. Father, let your miracles even flow. We don't look for them. We just walk in them. Let the shadows of your servants heal those that are wounded. Be still and know that He's Yah. There's no timetable. Time don't exist right now. We don't have any schedules right now. But Father, we walk in what you want us to walk in. I thank you that you're flooding Orange County right now with a spiritual wave of water, a tsunami that has not been seen anymore before. You're flooding Whittier. You're flooding Long Beach. You're flooding Pasadena. You're flooding the high desert. You're flooding, Father. Joseph is up and walking. Father, I pray that all rabbinic bondage that has been upon the people in any messianic or Hebraic circle, Father, it would be broken. The influence of Esau would be removed and destroyed, that the people would walk only in your covenant, the garments of your covenant only. Father, let the people see your name on our life, not just out of our mouth. Let us walk in the authority of the letters of your name. Let us know, like Shaul said, show me the power of your resurrection. Well, Yahweh Elohim says this. Actually, Yahweh Rafika says this. You have to die first in order to experience that power. So, Father, we choose to die to our flesh. We don't want our flesh overtaking us anymore. We want to loose all that off. We want to leave out of here different. The same way we came in, Father. We thank you so much. May we speak in boldness the truth of your word. Some might say, you got to pray for your enemies. The scripture says, pray for your enemies. The Mashiach was teaching us that those who were once your enemies that come to you for prayer, don't hold a blessing back from them. So we call in the rest of Israel. Loose them from that Islamic lie. The descendants of Abraham are everywhere. Father, I pray for the pastors in this region. I know all of these guys here and some of the women here. That you would enlighten them. Give them a nightmare, Father, which is really a blessing. And let them see the truth of your word to return back to your word 100%. No matter what the cost. This servant here, we were homeless, was home for a few years. Nothing. You watched over us when we had nothing. Hallelujah, Father. Perfect. Have your way. Have your way. We open up our entire heart. My heart is the wick. And your love is the flame, Father. My life is a wick. Cause my life to be engulfed in the flame of your love, Father. I don't want to leave the same here. I'm not going to. I don't want to play religion and come in here and play games. I want to be a real believer. I want to walk in the real Abba. Not just having intellectual discussions. But Father, we want to walk as the first century believers did. In that power and your truth. I want the children to come in here. And because of the anointing on our lives, they just lift their hands up. And they're in tune immediately. Thank you for your wave of compassion, Father, upon your people. Wave of love and healing on all levels. Father, may the sons return to the hearts of their fathers. In here, may every son that has strayed from their mom and their dad, may bring them home. Every son and daughter that has went wayward. Today, Abba, let there be a shaking out there. Wherever they are, shake their life. Keep shaking that, Father. Bring that son home. Bring that daughter home. Bring them home, Abba. Because of your name's sake. That's why. Not because of me or us. Because of your name's sake. Bring them home, Abba. Because of you. Because of you. Don't let them be destroyed, Father. Because guess what? They were raised in these things and strayed. Father, you don't want the nation saying that they were brought out of all this only to be destroyed. Bring them home, Abba. I pray for every son and daughter to come home. Bo benim. Come, sons and daughters, children. Bos, everybody say, bo benim. Come, children. Come home. Now, Father, our minds have been gone. I pray that mindsets will return. Mindsets, Father. I thank you right now, Abba. I thank you for your sweet spirit, Abba. Yeah, our feet might be hurting. Our knees might, back might be hurting. But you know what? I'm going away. Because you have such a sweet ruach. I remember the first things I did. You remember the first things you did, sister. You remember the first things you did, brother. Do those again. Do them again. You remember. It's never left. It's there. And today's the day it's rising up. You guys can do whatever the Ruach is moving on you to do right now. Stay standing up here. You can stay standing. If you want to praise Him. If you want to, whatever, I don't know. It's not. But I thank you, Abba. For your sweet peace. We'll stay here all day if you want us to, Abba. We'll stay here all day. You know, Father, we won't even move until you show up in my life. Can you guys say, no, I'm not moving until you show up in my life, Father. I'm not moving. I'm tired of the way everything. I'm not going to move until you do something in me. Change this hard heart. Change this mind, Father. I'm tired of living like this. How many people say that? You know what? I'm not moving until you do something in my life, Abba. For to me to live is Mashiach. So to die, I gain it all. So Abba, I know there's a work that's needed. I just need a little help. Just a little bit. I know you have a busy schedule, but I know you love me also. I just need a little help today. Just a touch in my life. Just to help me keep going. Just a little bit. Just a little, Father. Hallelujah. Heart is awake. Your love is a flame, and I want to know your name. I'm going to burn for your name. Hallelujah. However long it takes for you to receive what you need to receive, that's between you and the Father. Keep pressing in, man of Yah. Keep pressing in, woman of Yah. You're a soldier for the kingdom. Keep pressing in. Don't quit. You're not a quitter. He knows how hard it is. He went down to Egypt before the sons did. Remember that in chapter 46, verse 3. He says, I go down before you and I'll deliver you. He says, I was there before you ever came to that mess or that struggle. I was already there. I was there because I knew you were coming and I was there to pull you out of it. I was already there. There's no surprises to him. There's no surprises to him. He knows. You might not have asked for that sickness to come on your body. He was there. But he allowed that to happen so that you can reach out to him because he wants to show himself to you in a way you've never seen him before. I thank you, Father, that all worry is gone. All worry is gone. You are removing all worry, Father. I thank you so much. I thank you, Abba. You are so amazing. You are tov me'od. You are very good. You are tov me'od. Only you are. Even Mashiach said that. Don't even call him good. He says there's only one who's good. It's you. Tov. You're tov me'od. Abba, you're tov me'od. You are very good, Abba. You are so good to us. We don't deserve anything. You are so good to us. Thank you so much. Thank you, Abba. Thank you, Abba. Show us how to walk this thing out. We don't know nothing, Father. We don't know anything. All we know is Mashiach crucified. We've been given these things, Father. Let us walk these things out in great love. with one another, compassionate, long-suffering, patient with each other. Patient with each other. Teach us how to meet people where they're at, Father, so that you can touch their lives. We're not the Ruach HaKodesh. Thank you, Abba, for your mercy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. There's no rush. You guys, whatever he's doing, let him do it. Let him finish it. Let him know you're not leaving until you get all of it. You want it all. He wants you to be selfish for him. I thank you, Abba, that every need will be met today, Father. Every need. Let us be, Father, like that first century. We see a brother, sister struggling. Let's lay our life down for them. Let's take our jacket off and cover them. Let's be like Shem and Japheth. Let's cover our brother when they're in a place of struggle. Let's give them a garment where they... Let's give them a talit. Let's give them a place where they can pray. And we stand guard on the outside of that tent so they can be restored. You were so right this week, Father. You said you weren't playing games. That's the word you dropped in my spirit. He said, I'm not playing games. I know you're talking to me. But you're talking to all of us. We thank you, Abba. I pray that everybody leave here with the spirit of power, of love, and of a sound mind. 100%. We have no reason to fear anything, nothing. Father, when I was shot at, you were there. When I was stabbed, you were there, Father, and I'm still living. When I was left homeless for nothing, you were right there with me in the rain. And all I had was some long johns on with no shirt, no shoes, out in the gutter, in the rain. Father, you were there with me. You did that for me. Do that for anybody. I'm nobody without you. Nothing. You've had your hand on all of our lives. We all have a testimony, Abba. You've always been there. We're not going to give up. We're going to sing for you. We're going to praise you. We're going to study for our living. Study to know you. We're going to keep pressing in. We're not going to lay anything down, Father, because as we're in this Egypt system, we are going to let our light shine. Let our light shine. We want to hunger and thirst for righteousness, Abba. A hunger and thirst for righteousness, Abba. Let us taste it in even our taste buds. We begin to have this hunger and thirst for your word, for righteousness, Abba, like never before. Father, I thank you right now that the power of witchcraft is broken. Dark spells and Ouija board and evil incantations that is on someone's life here has been broken. I thank you, Father. I thank you, Abba. Father, our young people, give them a desire for set apartness and on all levels. That all forms of perversion would be kept completely away from them. That our young people would walk in modesty, spiritually, mentally, physically, emotionally. That us as adults, we would walk in modesty in our speech and how we hold ourselves on all levels, Abba. As we say in the morning, Modeh ani lefanecha melecha v'chayam she'echezarta b'nishmati b'chemla rabba v'netecha. We thank you. We're so grateful and thankful that you have restored our soul into our body. And in faithfulness you have done these things. And we praise you because you are so faithful in all that you do. And you young people, I'm going to tell you something. My heart goes out for you. We were all young one time. Some of us younger than others, but we were all young. Like you. I want to give you a word of encouragement. Make a stand for all holiness, all set apartness. And Abba will give you the biggest blessing, the biggest bracha that you have ever known. Make a stand in the midst of this chaotic world system. Thank you, Abba. And may we become prayer. Vani tefila. May we become prayer. Vani tefila. I am prayer. I am prayer. We might study for 4 or 5 hours a day, 6 hours a day at times. Let's see if we can make a commitment to pray for 4 or 5 hours a day and to be still on our knees and see what happens. The Father will show you the actual walls around you in your house will disappear. Your roof will literally, you won't be able to see it anymore. It would be gone because He rolled it open and He's bringing you into a place of powerful beauty. Thank you, Abba. I'm done, but if He's not done with you, that's fine. Hallelujah. Just let them finish it. It's all right. We're your brothers and sisters. We're here to encourage you. We're here to encourage you to keep going, to keep on going. Don't stop. Some works are deeper than others. Some works are longer than others. Some people have been through things that no one else has, and it just takes just a little longer. That's all right. That's all right. I want to see people transformed, really. I want to see people set free from the evil of the world. That's my heart's desire. I have an evangelist heart. I want to see people change. I'm an evangelist at heart. I didn't even want to be up here. Seriously, what, almost 9 years ago? I didn't really want to do this. Carol's fault. Bible studies at her house, and the Father just dropped the bomb on us. Well, He's not done yet. He's not done. He's not done yet. I'm going to read something here from Psalm 45, verse 1 through 8. Thus saith Yahweh to His anointed, to Sirius, whose right hand I have holden, to subdue nations before Him, and I will loose the loins of kings to open before Him the 2 leven gates, and the gates shall not be shut. I will go before you and make the crooked places straight. I will break in pieces the gates of judgment, brass, and cut in half the bars of iron. And I will give you the treasures of darkness, the hidden things, the hidden riches of secret places that you do not know. I, Yahweh, which call you by name, am the Elohim of Israel. For Jacob my servant's sake and Israel my elect, I have even called you by that name, and I have surnamed you, though you have not known me. I am Yahweh, and there is no one else. There is no Elohim beside me. I girded you, though you have not known me, that they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is none beside me. I am Yahweh, and there is none else. I form the light, and I create darkness. I make peace, and I create evil. I, Yahweh, do all these things. Drop down, you heavens, from above. And let the skies pour down righteousness. Let the earth open and let them bring forth salvation. And let righteousness spring up together. I, Yahweh, have created it. Amen and amen. Well, hallelujah. We don't take lightly anything, you guys. Anything. You know what? The first church I went to was a Baptist church in Long Beach. That was the first church I ever been to. I was the only light-skinned person there. And I learned some things there, believe it or not. Yeah. And the Father was doing things then. He's still doing them now. We all have been through a path. And I'm going to tell you this. You know what? The Father's not done with any of you. None of you. Pastor Joseph, you began that work. He's not done. He's just, it's amazing what he does. He does a sifting that doesn't feel good. But it's what's right. And it is good. The Father's not done with anybody in here. He's only getting started. So my prayer for you guys is that you would stay standing. Having done all to stand, stand. And just know, you know what? I struggle like you. You struggle like me. I'm not going to pretend to be some holier than thou. I am right here with you guys. When we started, I always said, I'm not over anyone. We're either locking arms side by side or we're not together at all. If you carry more and more people on one spot on top of you, you can't even walk. But if you lock arms, it's a lot stronger. We're equal. I just have been called to do something. And he's holding me to an accountability. So I know when to get the heck out the way. And just let him do what he has to do. And we've been in this season here for some reason. Literally the past like 4 weeks or so. We've just been praying for people. You know, and everything just mixed up. Everything set in order on the paper. But he just knows what he's doing. So I'm truly blessed to see what the Father is doing in your lives. And stay encouraged. Stay encouraged. Keep pressing in. Keep doing what he's called you to do. And do it with all your heart, soul, and strength until he comes. Until he says, that's it. It's time to punch out and go home. Do it with all your heart, soul, and strength. Don't quit and don't let anybody tell you, you can't do that. Sure you can. I can do all things through Mashiach, who is my strength. All things. All right, so are we bringing the... Okay. 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 See, I battled today, you guys. I battled you guys. So let's not go anywhere yet. If you have to go to the restroom, that's fine. But we're going to do one more thing. But I battled because there's a church that uses the building. And I came in and there was a Christmas tree here. A wreath right here. And I said, give me a lighter. So this is something that I have to battle with because of